Hello YouTube, and welcome to Hidden Hacks. As an addition to my ongoing PC overhaul project, today we are going to have a look at the H115i RGB Platinum All-in-One Water Cooler and LL120 RGB Fan from Corsair, do some unboxing, setup process, and as a sort of PSA, we'll also talk about some common issues that AMD processor owners may or may not experience while installing the stock cooler or an aftermarket one. Also, this video contains graphic images that are not PCMR friendly. Please continue on your own accord. Let's go! I bought this one a few days after building my first workstation PC. Click right here to check it out, by the way. And I installed it just last August 5. A week or so before posting my preliminary benchmark results. Alright, let's proceed. So, here's the LL120 RGB fan that will accompany the three LL120 intake fans at the front of the case. I will use this one as an exhaust at the back. Here's the H115i box. Okay, let's open it up. Inside the box is the warranty and quick start guide. Two pieces of Corsair ML140 Pro RGB fans, the CPU water block and pump, a micro USB to USB header that will be attached to the motherboard for IQ integration, mounting kits for all the modern Intel and AMD CPUs, and lastly, the 280mm radiator that will be placed at the top of the case, and will act as an exhaust as well. Look at that shiny sticker but not actually a sticker looking Corsair logo. Fancy! After unboxing, let's start by removing the stock cooler. But I think I'm going to remove the GPU first to move things more freely. Now, this is the common issue or problem that I am talking about in the intro. After unlatching the latch, the CPU just goes along with the copper plate of the cooler. I'm not sure why this is happening, but according to some forums, apparently, I should have run my PC for a while first before removing the cooler so that the thermal paste is not that sticky yet. But, being a former Intel user, I just thought that the CPU wouldn't come off that easily. I mean, look at that!
No bent pins though, luckily.
I'm going to try and remove it as safely as I can. As you can see, it's stuck on it like glue, and the only way to remove it is by twisting it like this. Now, let's remove the remaining thermal paste. First up, put the CPU onto the motherboard where it can be safe. Then, clean the copper plate of the cooler. Now, I know that I have said that I lost the footage for the other stock cooler test on my preliminary benchmark results video.
That was a lie.
The truth is, I just did not go with it. See, my original plan was to do a stock clock, stock cooler, and stock thermal paste for the first test. Then, a stock clock, stock cooler, and an aftermarket thermal paste for the second test. But as you will see later, I scrapped that idea and just moved on. So, this is the part where I used CryoNaut as my aftermarket thermal paste if everything went as planned. But, just like on most of my projects, everything went south. This is the part where things got a little bit scary. So, as I was struggling to close the latch of the stock cooler while at the same time adjusting stuff to make things easier, I did not notice that the CPU came out of its socket while still attached to the cooler's copper plate, and this is what happened.
Warning. Not safe for PC Master Race content ahead. Viewer discretion is advised.
The previous stuff that I did just to try and close the latch resulted in this. Bent. F***ing. Pins. I got really scared, of course, since I just bought this one and can't RMA it because it was my fault. But I guess it's still a good thing. Because, now you know what will happen if you don't treat your stuff with care and if you don't pay that much attention while installing something delicate. And in the end, everything worked out just fine, because I have experienced the same thing on my old Intel motherboard. I just use a box cutter blade as carefully and as gently as I can to straighten the pins. Wouldn't want to make things worse by damaging the PCB, of course. And that's the main reason why the second test was trashed. By the way, I ended up not using the CryoNaut at all. I just used the thermal paste that came with my Cooler Master Master Air G100M Air Cooler. Click right here to check it out if you want to. Okay, first let's remove the fan tray that is located at the top of the case. After that, install the brackets onto the CPU water block like this. Then, get these things and these things. Screw them to the CPU brackets like this. And hook them up to the mounting brackets like this. Tighten it up a little, and that's it. After installing the CPU water block or pump onto the motherboard, let's install the radiator. As you can see here, I have already installed both the fans and the radiator onto the fan tray. So I have removed the radiator here so that I can insert the cables onto the cutouts easily. You don't have to do this if your case is different or if you don't want to, of course. Then, all I need to do now is to stash all the cables to the back of the case and manage them there. Okay, first are the wires that are coming from the water pump, then the wires from the fans. After that, let's boot the radiator back. Before we continue, let's open this box first. Here it is. These are the cables for the power and RGB control. And let's install this one right here. After that, time to connect and manage the cables at the back. Okay, here it is. The back exhaust fan's power and RGB wires are both connected to the Corsair Commander Pro. And the ML140 Pro RGB fan's power and RGB wires are both connected to the Corsair H115i cables. All the extra length of wires are stashed near the power supply, because it's the only vacant space and it's covered by the power supply shroud anyway. Now for some protective plastic peeling porn. Or not. After setting it up on IQ, it's time for some glamour shots.